is the Holy Spirit plain. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
John Osteen said, this is my Bible, my very own Bible. You know, I did that one time, some lady, and we were on television. A lady wrote me and said, that was John Osteen, she stole it. I thought, oh, dear Lord, are you that uptight? I borrowed that from John, not Joel, John Osteen. I have disclaimed. Bless your darling heart. And I won't say the rest of what Brother Hagin said. He said stupid heads. I didn't say it. I was just telling you what he would say. Hallelujah. Today we're going to talk about the power of his resurrection. Glory to God. How many are glad that Jesus was raised from the dead? How many are glad that he brought life to us? How many are glad that you're not dead? Oh my, I'm glad I'm not dead, but I'm alive. Hallelujah. I'm glad that Jesus came. Hallelujah. The Apostle Paul in the book of Philippians wrote and said this. He said, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. I'm glad we're walking in faith righteousness and not law righteousness. How about you? I'm glad I don't have to keep a bunch of ordinances. I'm glad I'm not carrying a lamb or a meal offering or a dove offering or a sacrificial offering or a trespass offering up to the priest today to have it offered. I'm glad that one came 2,000 years ago, glory be to God, and entered in with his own blood to obtain eternal redemption for us. Can somebody shout glory?
Glory.
I'm glad that the high priest offered him up. Hallelujah. And he was crucified for us. Amen. Hallelujah. And now I have faith righteousness. I don't do it. It's not based on the law. Paul goes on and says in verse 10, that I may know him. Oh my. And the power of his resurrection. And the fellowship of his sufferings. Being made conformable unto his death. I messed that one up. Conformable. There we go. Got it. Unto his death. If by any means are in the hope that I might obtain the resurrection of the dead. Thank God. You know, we have been made conformed to his death. How? He became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Hallelujah. Ephesians, the second chapter, tells us that we were raised up with him and made to sit with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Glory to God. I want you to know that Jesus went to the cross and Jesus died and his life was poured out and he was taken from that place and taken to the place of torment and judgment where he was judged of God for the sins of humanity. Not just the very acts of sin, but the very nature of sin. God's wrath was poured out on him. He was judged, where so much so that in the 22nd Psalm, he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? You read the whole 22nd Psalm. That is from the cross until his declaration of his resurrection. Go there. We're just not going to stop there. We're going to go there. Psalm 22. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? You've heard that. That most theologians believe that Jesus quoted the 22nd Psalm on the cross. And the reason is because they quote the first verse, and then the last verse, it says in the King James, on the cross, it says, it is finished. And the literal Hebrew is, he hath done this. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from me and from my words of my roaring, from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Oh, my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not. In the night season to be silent, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee, they trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee and were delivered, they trusted in thee, and they were not confounded. But I am a worm, I'm no man, a reproach of men, despise the people. All they see me laugh at me and to scorn. They shoot out the lip and they shake their head, saying, he trusted in the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. This is what Jesus experienced on the cross. They would come to him and begin to speak, and rail out. Even the thieves railed out against him. But thou art me who took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon thee from the womb, and thou art my God from my mother's belly. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. For the bulls, the many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water. This is begins the description of a man crucified. I am poured out of water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. Now remember, when they came to Jesus, they broke the legs of the thieves on each side of him. Because they were trying, because it was getting dark, they wanted to get him buried. So they broke the legs to expedite the death process. When they came to Jesus, he was dead already, so they pierced his side with a sword. And it says that water and blood came out. Well, really what it was the heart sac. Jesus' heart exploded. And the heart sac around the heart had filled with the blood, and then the blood's corpuscles separated. The red corpuscles separated from the white corpuscles, and you had that clear serum, and then the thicker with the darker red or darker corpuscles. And when they poked that spear into his side, they punctured that heart sac, and the clear liquid ran out first, followed by the thicker, where his heart had just burst in his chest. From the strain of the crucifixion, the strain of being made sin for us who knew no sin, the strain of all sickness and disease coming on him at the cross. In Gethsemane, he sweat tears of blood. You know, the vessels in his forehead, the small capillaries burst and blood came out in his sweat. The strain of being man's sacrifice, of having his Father judge him. For us, caused his heart to burst. My tongue, my strength is dried up like a potsherd. My tongue cleaveth to my jaws. It's completely dehydrated. 25% of body weight could be lost in a crucifixion from dehydration. My tongue cleaveth to my jaws. Thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For the dogs, when he thinks about the devil and his crowd, for dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. This is 1,500 years before Romans began using crucifixion as a means of execution. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones. They look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them and cast lots for my vesture. Go read. They wouldn't even tear his sash because it was so expensive. They cast lots for it. Deliver my be not far from me, O Lord, my strength. Haste thee to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling, from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. I will declare thy name. Now here's what's happening. Now you think this confession stuff is a bunch of goobity-gawk. You think confession is a bunch of, you know, hocus-pocus mess, the name it, claim it, frame it bunch. The master himself began to confess. In the midst of being made sin for us who knew no sin, in the midst of the judgment of God coming on him, in the midst of being gaped upon by the mouths of a ravening and roaring lion, having all the dogs and the forces of hell and coming against him, he says, I will declare thy name unto my brethren, and in the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. Ye that fear the Lord, praise him, all ye seed of Jacob. Glorify him and fear him, all ye the seed of Israel. For he hath not despised nor abhorred the afflicted, affliction of the afflicted, neither hath he hid his face from him. When he cried unto him, he heard, my praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear him. The meek shall eat and be satisfied. They shall praise the Lord that seek him. Your heart shall live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. For the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the governor among the nations. Now all that would be fat upon the earth shall eat and worship. All thee that go down to dust shall bow before him, and none shall keep alive his own soul. A seed shall serve him. A seed, not seeds. A seed shall serve him. And if you be Christ, then are you Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise. It shall be accounted to the Lord for a generation. They shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that he hath done this. Now when you read the New Testament account, it says it is finished. This is the same phraseology, but you understand languages and stuff sometimes kind of come across a little bit different when you translate and all that kind of stuff. But it's the same phrase. He hath done this. He said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He's suffering at the cross, being a sin for us. Hallelujah. But Peter got up on the day of Pentecost and said, it was not possible. Somebody shout glory. It was not possible that death should hold him. Hallelujah. The grave couldn't keep him down. Hallelujah. Glory to God. When you go into the book of Hebrews, it says that God said, let all the angels, when he bringeth the first begotten into the world, he saith, let all the angels of God worship him. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, glory to God, Jesus got up, stripped Satan of his authority, began to walk across that gulf. David began to dance. Hallelujah. I mean, they said, there's the will within the will. There's Jacob's ladder. Hallelujah. There's the Lord that said unto my Lord that sat at the right hand. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. There's the one I wrestled with. Hallelujah. Abraham said, there is the one who said, my name shall be called Abraham. Hallelujah. I want you to know that there was a smoking in the fiery furnace that walked across that gulf, glory to God, and said, I am he who was alive and was dead, but now I'm alive forevermore, glory to God. I've been raised up as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, hallelujah, and preached unto those held in captivity, and they followed him up out of the ground, hallelujah. The book of Matthew says that many of the graves were opened, and the Old Testament saints came out and walked in the streets. That'll mess up your day. Here comes great, great Uncle Charlie. For dinner. Been dead for 40 years. Are you here? They're sitting down at Passover meal, and all of a sudden one of their relatives comes in. One of the relatives walks in and sits down and says, I was just with him. Hallelujah. I saw him walk across the gulf. Hallelujah. Where is he? He just went by. Mary tried to get a hold of him, but he said, don't clutch me. Got to let go. I'm not yet going to my Father and to your Father, to my God and your God. I got my blood. I got to go to the mercy seat. I got to enter into that one and last time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible says he led captivity captive. Hallelujah. And they're all standing outside the gate. They can't enter in where he's going. Not yet. He goes to the Holy of Holies, holy place, and walks into the heavenly Holy of Holies and brings his blood right up to the place that Adam had transgressed and sinned and carried all of man's authority and given it to Satan, right before the throne of God. And Jesus walks in with his own blood. There's great silence in heaven because this is what he left to return for. He begins to do the high priestly ministry, the last official sacrificial act of any high priest. Not after the order of Aaron, but after the order of Melchizedek. And he sprinkles his blood on that mercy seat. And with great anticipation, all of creation groans at that moment. In earnest, that at this moment, the fate of all humanity and the creation of God, and let me say this, of Jesus himself, is at stake. Hallelujah. But as he sprinkles that blood on the mercy seat, the Father receives and says, forgiven. The chains and authority and the power of Satan over humanity is crushed. And mankind can now leave at will Satan's authority. Again, Ephesians says we were raised up with him. At the time of Jesus' resurrection, every human was resurrected. Past, present, and future. They were the power of the resurrection to not only raise Jesus from the dead, but all humanity was raised up with him in the mind of God. Now some will reject and some will not accept, but as far as God's concerned, he's already done the work to raise him. And set him at his own right hand. The power of the resurrection raised Jesus. If the same Spirit that raised Christ up from the dead dwell in you, it's going to make alive, quicken your mortal body. He's made us alive. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 3, 4, 13, 4, 13, 4. For though he was crucified through weakness, yet he liveth by the power of God. For we are also weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God toward you. 2 Corinthians 1:10. Who shall deliver us from so great a death? And doth deliver. What is God? God does deliver. In whom we also trust, and he will yet deliver us. And Jesus told them at, I believe Lazarus' tomb, said John 11:25. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection. No, he didn't. This went there. I'm sorry. And the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Whosoever liveth and believeth in him, in me shall never die. Believest thou this? What did he say? I am the resurrection. His resurrection power. The power of God to not only raise Jesus from the dead, but to raise humanity from the dead with what kind of death? Not physical death. It wasn't the physical death that he was being raised from, that we're being raised from. It is spiritual death. It is separation from the Father. It is alienated from God, from the covenants of God, alienated from his life, from his light, from his love. We were separated from that. But the resurrection resurrects man, resurrects humanity out of Satan's authority and out of Satan's power and out of Satan's domain and translates us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He took us from being children of the devil and made us children of God. Heirs of God. Joint heirs with Jesus. No longer bound by the dictates of an evil taskmaster. No longer bound to obey the flesh. No longer bound to obey the spirit of disobedience, the spirit of the world that works in the children of disobedience, but liberated by the resurrection power of God that he used to raise Jesus from the dead. Satan had him. They gaped upon him with their mouths. They're having a party in hell. We defeated the plan of God. We defeated the plan of God. He who knew no sin was made sin. Glory to God. But Peter said it was not possible that he should be holding of death. The grave couldn't keep him down. I believe that song, I can't remember if it was Candy Staten or the little lady that sang on TBN all the time. Ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Oh my. I said, oh my. I want you to know that there's a resurrection power working in you today. There is resurrection life working in you today. What does it do? I get amazed at people who want to say that God's resurrection power is in you, and God's making you sick, and God's making you poor, and God's beating you, and God's trying to kill you. God's trying to do all this stuff in you. When he put his power in you, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Glory be to God. I want you to know it's resurrection life. It's holy life. It's the power life of God on the inside of you that raises you up. Hallelujah. It's not that you can stay in the mud. He took you out of the mud. Put your feet on the rock. Glory to God. We walk in the high places because resurrection power lifts us out of Satan's domain. King James says in the book of Romans, I believe it is, that we when we're in him and we're in God, that we walk in newness of life. An alternate translation, I can't remember if it's Weymouth or Wiest or some other translation, but there's another translation that says this, that we were raised up to live in a whole new sphere altogether. Oh my. What do you mean? I'm not living in the place where the flesh has control. I'm not living in the place where the mind has control. I'm not living in the place where Satan has control. There's resurrection power working in me. Hallelujah. And it lifts me up to a new sphere. What kind of sphere? To walk in the Spirit. To be in the Spirit. To live above. Hallelujah. To be the head and not the tail. Above only and not beneath. Blessed coming in and blessed going out. Glory to God. It's the power of God. Resurrection power. Work it in me. It's the life of God in me. It says no more. No more does Satan have power. No more does Satan have authority. I can look at him and say, no. You can't put that on me. Let's go. George Jefferson. You jive turkey. Remember that? Remember the Jeffersons? George Jefferson liked to call people jive turkeys. There's a new life. My spirit's been made alive unto God. The resurrection power took dead, alienated human spirits. Jesus said, you must be born again. Confessing with our mouth and believing in our heart, and his Lord, confess him as Lord, that Jesus is my Lord. And believe in your heart that God's raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. At that moment, Jesus said, you must be born again. His life comes in. And the resurrection power of Christ that raised him up from the dead enters into your human spirit, and you're made alive unto God. No longer a stranger. Hallelujah. But a child of God. The Master and the Father walk in and set up camp in your spirit. And you're alive unto God. Hallelujah. There's a new man. A new species of being that never existed before. Called the new creation man. Where God's life is entered. And man is but one step short of the complete restoration to the garden status. What's the last step? The glorification of your body. But we've been sealed, according to Ephesians, with the spirit of promise until the day of the purchase possession. Your body's coming. What? This mortal shall put on immortality, this corruptible shall put on incorruption. We'll be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And we'll meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Listen, your body has a future redemption, but your spirit is already alive unto God. Your mind's being renewed, and you got the promise of the body. What do you do with it? You get it healed. His resurrection. If the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwell in you, it shall quicken your mortal body. Now, it didn't say it would change for not being mortal. You're going to die eventually if Jesus doesn't come back. But your mortal body will be made alive. The life of God affects your mortal body. It's a law Paul called in the book of Romans in the eighth chapter. He said the law of the spirit of life, what's that, resurrection power, in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. What's he saying? The law, the spirit of life in Christ Jesus countermands all the dictates and all the orders and all the decorations of the law of sin and death. I don't have to submit. I don't have to yield. I don't have to acquiesce to anything the law of sin and death says. Because I got a new law working in me through resurrection life. And it lifts me. It lifts you. It takes us from the place of defeat to victory. Are you here? He translated us out of the kingdom of darkness. And having spoiled, the book of Colossians says, I believe chapter 2. I'm not going to quote it right away. I'm going to get there. Let's go there. Colossians. Can somebody say hallelujah? There's power in the resurrection. His resurrection power, glory to God, lifted us up out of Colossians 1:20. Okay. Where is it? Amen. What scripture is, it's are y'all, everybody calling out? Okay. Hey, there we go. 2:15. I thought it was verse 20. Hallelujah. Verse 13. And you being dead in your sins and uncircumcision of your flesh, that's where you were. Hath he quickened together. How? Through the power of the resurrection. He quickened us together while you were dead in your trespasses and sins. Verse 13 of Colossians chapter 2. And said this. Quickened us, made us alive. Kent quickens old King Jimmy for made alive. Together with him, having forgiven you your trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. And the verse 20, 15. And having spoiled. This was the word they use in Greek literature when the Romans would defeat a people. They would spoil the people. What they would do is they would the ones they didn't kill, they would keep the strong men alive, put them in cages, march them down in a parade before all the people, and show their strong men defeated. Often take them out and drag them by the hair of their head and just humiliate them in the streets before the people that had been defeated, show even your strongest can't withstand us. And Jesus spoiled the principalities and the powers. He made a show of them openly. Hallelujah. What does it say next? What's the next word? Triumphing. Triumphing. Jesus' triumphal march through hell, defeating the enemy, stripping him of his crown of glory, you know, getting it back for humanity, taking the strong man, Satan, made a show. You bruise his heel, he'll bruise your head. Yeah. Jerry Savelle used to say, down in Texas, that phrase would be, bust your head. Jesus went to the devil and busted his head. Jesus stripped him and took back the keys of death and of hell. You can't hold a man any longer if he doesn't want to be held. See, before you could, you had no choice. You couldn't get out of it. Even in a covenant with God, you couldn't be reconciled to God under the old covenant. You had to wait until Jesus showed up. They had to wait. That's why the Bible says that the prophets longed for our day. They were looking for our day. So they died with a promise. We die in the promise. So much so that the Apostle Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. We don't go to Abraham's bosom and wait. Absent from the body, I go to be with the Lord. The prophets long for this day. Hallelujah. They long for this day. They were looking for this day. When you read Isaiah, he says, by his stripes we are healed. By the time Peter quotes that, he says, by his stripes we were healed. Isaiah is looking to a date that's coming. Peter looks back to a date that's been accomplished. They're looking for the resurrection. The resurrection has come. We're not waiting to get saved. We are. When you get born, when you receive Jesus, you're born again. You don't have to wait. It's right then. The power of the resurrection to transform your life from a man or a woman outside of God to being made one with Him. Whereby He sent His Spirit into our hearts and we cry out, Abba, Daddy. The best English word we can come up with for Abba is Daddy, Father. Not, see? The relation's the father side. The daddy, I mean, you know, you're born of him. He's your father. But the daddy is the intimate, one with God side. His spirit of adoption has been sent to ours. We cry, Abba, Father. Because of the power of the resurrection. Because of God's power to take man and woman through faith in Jesus Christ, by being become one with Him from their estate to a heavenly estate. And having spoiled principalities and powers, He made a show of them openly. Triumphing over them in it. Amen? Glory to God. He triumphed heaven was full of joy. As the work that Satan worked in the Garden of Eden, where man fell to the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, and captured humanity and brought them into captivity, as he mocked God, because the Bible says in the book of Job, there's a day that the sons of God went to present themselves before the throne of God. And Satan came, and God said, if you consider my servant Job. Now, let me tell you something. Can I help you all out with Job just a little bit? You need to do a little bit better reading, this reading surface. The phrase, have you considered my servant Job, is, have you set your heart on my servant Job, literally in Hebrew. Satan came. He didn't know how far his authority went, and he was going to make sure he didn't mess up. He came to find out. God said, well, because Job was offering sacrifice for his kids and for his wife and all this mess, you know, and all the stuff happening to him, God said, you can't touch him. See, Job, we see nowhere in there, Job was in fear for his own life. So you couldn't touch him. The hedge had been dropped because of fear about what his children were doing. Let me say something else. He got it all back double. You hear some people talk, God does this and God does that. You know, it's like that country song. Got the dog back, got the kids back, got the wife back, got double. You know, when you play country. Job got it all back. Double. God didn't sick the devil on him. Satan wanted to know. And God said, have you set your heart on my servant Job? Yeah, but you've got a hedge about him. He said, everything is in his hand is yours, except you can't touch his life. And then Job cries out in the third chapter and says this, because of fear, this has come on me. Because I was afraid this has befallen me. Fear opened the door. Not God sicking the devil on him. I don't know, I got on Job, but there you go. Now we are raised up. We're no longer, as Jesus said to the religious folk in John 8:44, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will fulfill. We're now called something different. We're the new creation men and women. We're born of God. We're raised up with him and seated with him in heavenly places. Our life is now hid in Christ, glory to God. I'm telling you right now, when the devil looks at you, the only way he can find out who you are is to get you to say something you shouldn't say. What do you mean? You look like Jesus. You're not Jesus, but you're in him. So he's got to get you to say something that Jesus wouldn't say. So don't say it. Say what Jesus would say. Hello? Then the devil don't know who he's dealing with. I don't believe that. This hush. Go watch somebody else if you don't believe it. We love you. But, you know, you can sit there and argue all day long. The fact of the matter is, we look like Jesus. Do you know what happened on the day of Pentecost? They all stumbled out of that room, got filled with the Holy Ghost, and there's 3,000 more people get saved. They got 3,120 folk out there all looking like Jesus, and the devil don't know what to do. I thought we crucified him. We got him. He went back to heaven. Yeah, but 3,000 just showed up. Before the week's end, they got another 5,000. They got 8,120. The devil don't know what to do. I said the devil doesn't know what to do because they all look like Jesus. Why? Because they're born of God. The life of God's entered. That's what resurrection power does. It lifts you. It separates you from the world. It puts you in a new sphere. The Bible says we've done this, so we should walk in newness of life. Put off the old man and put on the new. What's he mean? Stop letting the old things of flesh, the things of the flesh dictate and control. You don't have to anymore. You are not Flip Wilson's alter ego, Geraldine. The devil made me do it, honey. The devil can't make you do anything anymore. I just couldn't. Yes, you can't help yourself. Not in your strength. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit. Armies is when not by might, not by armies, but by my spirit. Now, the Bible says that the same spirit raised Christ from the dead. The Bible also tells us that he was raised by the power or the glory of God. What are we talking about? It's the Holy Spirit is the resurrection power.
that was administered to Jesus and is administered in your life. And he now dwells in you. And you could say, greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. And when, and when, and when, and when, and when, and when, and when. Can somebody say amen? You can keep winning because Jesus, the resurrection life God. Say, but this world's bad. This world's bad. Yeah, but we're not of this world. Did you not know that the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that we're ambassadors for Christ? What is an ambassador? Someone who is living somewhere but is not part of there. The Russian ambassador to the United States is not an American. He's a Russian living in America. He has diplomatic immunity from our laws. He lives in the Russian consulate. That is a Russian ground. That is considered as much a part of Russia as the city of Moscow. If you go to Moscow, the American embassy is considered just as much American ground as Washington, D.C. When you are an ambassador, you are in another place. Though you are in that place, you're not of that place. And you're ambassadors for Christ, glory to God. And though we're in this world, we are not of this world, glory to God. And the life of God on the inside of us gives us immunity against all the forces of darkness. Hallelujah. Jesus said, behold, I give you power. When he spoke to the 70, over all the power of the enemy, glory to God. God give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. And over all the power of the enemy, hallelujah. All authority is granted unto me in heaven and earth. Therefore you go, and in my name, cast out devils. Come out! Speak with new tongues. If you drink any deadly thing, it won't hurt you. You'll take up serpents. Now that does not mean go have a snake handling service. Like one guy said one time, they went and do a musical concert somewhere, had dropped extension cords 2 miles up to the church. Got on the platform, and the guy said, what's those baskets? He said, you'll find out. About halfway through the service, you know, one woman ran there and threw the top off, grabbed the rattlesnake out of there and started dancing all over the place. He looked at the pastor and said, where's the back door? He said, we don't have one. He said, where do you want it? Hallelujah. No. You'll take up serpents. Now, it can be literal in the sense like Paul in the Isle of Miletus, that the serpent bit him. He shook it off. They waited for him to die. He didn't die. They all started getting saved. And can also refer that you're going to be exercising authority. You're going to be walking in authority over Satan's power and authority. You don't drink strychnine, but if something happens and you accidentally poison, you can claim immunity in Jesus' name. Amen? Hallelujah. And you'll lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. We, by the power of the resurrection, are to exhibit Christ in the earth and to walk like him. That's cocky, Pastor. Nope, Jesus said. And if Jesus said it, I can quote him. Are you here? The works that I do shall ye do, and greater than these, because I go to the Father. And the Holy Spirit has come to enforce or to empower or to deliver the resurrection power of God into every believer's life. To live victorious. Can somebody shout glory? Can somebody say hallelujah? Somebody else say amen. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. In the days that we're coming into, the hour that we're living in, we're going to have to know that we're living a resurrection life. You can't bawl, whine, and squall every time something goes wrong because, you know, it's tough. I don't like the politicians. Well, who does? Well, I like the last president. I like the new president. I couldn't stand the last one. I can't stand the new one. You're going to let them mess up the rest of your life? Politicians are like the weather in North Carolina. You don't like it, wait 5 minutes. It'll change. Hello. Our state got together and banned, you know, the use of bathrooms by people other than your gender, sex, your not your identity, but who you are. And because the ACC and the NCAA and the NBA and everybody else started pulling out, they changed the law. They just changed. You can't count on politicians, but you can count on Jesus. And He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And yet I'm telling you that when life throws the storms at you, you can walk on water. What if I sink? Peter did not get dragged back to the boat. He walked back to the boat. I know he sank, but he cried, the Lord took his hand, and they walked back together. Some people think that Jesus, come on, Peter, you old unbelieving rascal, just drug him back. He's back there like somebody hanging onto a ski rope that forgot to let go. Look. Him, have you ever done that? I've done it. You forget to let go, you're thinking, you're never going to get your feet back around with the skis on. Let go of the rope. Well, Jesus isn't dragging Peter back. Peter just sucking up seawater. They got them all back together. What's that tell me? Even when you mess up, the resurrection power will lift you back up. When you reconnect with it, just lift you back up and take you back. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the service. We thank you for all those who are watching. We trust that what they now have a revelation of is that being in Christ, His resurrection power is working in them. That greater is He that is in us than he that's in the world. That we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. And we're no longer children of darkness, but children of the light. We're no longer children of Satan, where Jesus said, you're of your father the devil in John 8:44. But now we're heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, that God is our Father. Behold how wonderful it is, John says, to be called the sons of God. Now are we the sons of God. Now, let us live in the resurrection life. Let us live in that which the Master purchased for us through His own blood. And peradventure there be those in this room or those watching by the internet that Jesus is not your Lord. You've not yet come into a relationship. You've not experienced the resurrection power of God. May this be their day they say yes. That today is a day of salvation. They won't harden their heart, but they'll say yes. If you're watching, you're in this room. And just ask all those here with us today to repeat the prayer. I know if you're born again, you're just repeating it for our sake, but repeat this prayer with us so that those watching, in your living room, in your car, you're sitting at Starbucks this morning. You turn this on for whatever reason, and now you're sitting there, and you think, I don't know that power. This is your day to know the power. To know what it means to be raised out of death into life. See, Almighty God, I come to you today. I have heard that Jesus died for my sin. I've heard that you raised Him from the dead for my justification. Therefore, I confess that He is the Lord of my life. I believe in my heart that you raised Him from the dead and accept Him as my Lord. I do so in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that's simple. Why didn't I confess my sins? Because Jesus came to deal with your sin nature. The Bible says if you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised Him from the dead, you'll be saved. Romans chapter 8. We would ask you, you can do a couple things. If you're watching by internet, you can send us something on the Facebook page, or you can email me at office@fvc.org. That's the church's initials. office@fvc.org. You'll send, that you got saved, you accept the Lord. We want to be able to communicate with you, see where you are, and see if we can't get you into a good church. If you're in another state, another place, we'd love to get you into a good church. We know a lot of pastors. We know a lot of people we can get you connected with that'll be a blessing to your life. You need to be in a good church. You need to have a pastor. You need to have somebody watch over you. So if you pray that, and that was the first time, you don't have a church. You know, you're just, I just came to the Lord. We can get you somewhere that'll help you. So please, email us, let us know, comment on the Facebook page, or the live feed if you need to, if you don't have any other means. We'll get the information to you. Get as close as we can to, so you can have somebody you can go sit under that will be there for you in person. Praise the Lord. If you're living in the Greensboro area, the Greensboro, Winston-Salem, High Point, the Piedmont Triad, come visit us here at Faith and Victory Church. Come see what we have here. We want to bless and minister to your life. And until the next time, we speak life over you. We speak blessing over you. We say this, that this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.